Imagine the wrong assumption about prayer. If the spiritual life be healthy under the full power of the Holy Spirit, praying without ceasing will be natural. It really is hard to see the forest through the trees. We can get so entrenched with the details that we never really consider the big picture. That happens big time with prayer, which often comes with some monstrous expectation and invisible assumptions. The biggest assumption is that we are always supposed to pray more than we do. If you don't pray a lot, you obviously aren't serious about God. And if more people like you would just pray more, then our world and our nation wouldn't be going to hell in a handbasket, right? Verses like this might only fuel your struggle. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Add this all together and you might feel like a first-class spiritual loser. Or maybe you try to dodge it by saying, I don't have the gift of prayer. What is the problem here? Is God setting us up for failure and condemnation? Not at all. The problem is much more fundamental than that. Most of our traditions, teachings, and examples miss the simple, pure, liberating essence of prayer. Prayer is an intimate conversation with the one who passionately loves you and lives in you. A race for a moment. If you can, everything you think you know about what prayer looks like, how you are supposed to do it, and how much you are expected to do it. Consider this simple definition. Really think about it, both what prayer is and also what prayer is not. What is the big picture? Can you see the forest, the prayer possibilities through the trees of your assumptions? Holy Spirit, I need your help here. I am excited about the opportunity to pray without ceasing, using all kinds of prayers and requests. Right now, begin to open my mind to the possibilities of a life praying in you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. What real prayer looks like? When prayer becomes secondary or incidental, it has lost its power. Those who are conspicuously men of prayer are those who use prayer as they use food or air or light or money. In Ephesians chapter 6, Paul challenges us to pray in the Spirit. That brings up an interesting question. Is it actually possible to pray in the flesh? Could someone actually pray as part of a performance-based system to gain favor with God? Absolutely. Remember, Jesus coming down on the Pharisees. Don't pray like the Pharisees pray, for they stand on the street corner to be seen by everyone. They were performing for people. They weren't praying, right? Instead, Jesus told us to get in the closet where no one can see us. But even in the closet, isn't it quite possible that our prayers are seen as a duty to be fulfilled through self-effort rather than an opportunity to communicate with God? Let's consider this simple, pure definition of prayer again. Prayer is an intimate conversation with the one who prays. on one level, we can thinking, discussing, seeing, calculating, meeting all the demands of external affairs, but deep within, behind the scenes, at a profounder level, we may also be in prayer and adoration, song and worship, and a gentle receptiveness to divine breathings. Sometimes my family and I would hold hands around the dinner table at the end of the day. We would close our eyes and bow our heads, thanking God for a table full of food, a family that loves each other, and a life worth dying for. Preaching on Sundays was somewhat similar. I would ask everyone to bow their heads and pray that God would teach us His truth. At the end of the sermon, we would bow our heads again, close our eyes, and ask God to apply what we had learned. At once, I got back to my office. I would get on my knees and raise my empty hands toward heaven, focusing solely on intimate conversation with the God who loves me. I am all for structured times full of prayer, but prayer is in no way limited by the words squished between dear God and amen. Prayer can be a never ceasing intimate conversation with the one who loves us. Consider these scriptural truths. Pray without ceasing, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. The Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, and pray in the Spirit of all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Walk by the Spirit. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, amen.
Greater things, something along those lines.
was prophesying over the city. Slowly, this group emerged. The band began to fill in with voices and instruments, praying in the spirit with music. The spirit's words flowing through them began to come together in a passionate, intimate conversation with God. Their spirit was writing a new song on the spot. You are the God of this city. You are the King of this people. You are the Lord of this nation. You are the light in this darkness. You are the hope to the hopeless. You are the peace to the restless. You are. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. The song, God of this city, is now sung worldwide. What is the Spirit going to sing in your heart today? Are you listening to what He is going to pray with through you? Holy Spirit, I am listening. As we walk together today, lead our conversation. Speak to me and pray through me with all kinds of prayer in all situations. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Giving out of your nothing, mail your packages early so the post office can lose them in time for Christmas. There's 100 reasons you might be saying, I don't have anything left to give this Christmas. If that's where you think you are, what's your reason? Maybe it's financial. It could even be that you have recently received notice at work. They are downsizing and you got some kind words and a pink slip just in time for the holidays. Maybe it's material. You have had to tell your kids not to expect as much for Christmas this year. You have talked about downsizing the home and they might have to move away from their school and friends. Maybe it's emotional. Perhaps your marriage is crumbling, but you are supposed to be happily married this time of year, so you are pretending on the outside. Sometimes we stress about what to give the person who has everything, but what do you do when you are the person with nothing? The biblical account of the first Christmas offers hope and perspective. A quick review of the key players in the Christmas story reveals that most of them had nothing to give. A husband without a home, an innkeeper without a room, a young mother with nothing to clothe her just born son. But they discovered that in giving what they did have, they could find joy as they found themselves in God's masterful plan. And He said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. Paul realized his emptiness was an opportunity to experience the fullness of Christ and share that power with others. Is it possible that this was God's intent all along, that His Son should be given to the world through those who had nothing without Him? Dear Lord, I thank you for all I am, weak and empty on the outside, powerful and full on the inside, just as you used Joseph, an innkeeper, and a pregnant young woman. Live through me in a way that brings Jesus and joy to the world around me. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us not be satisfied with just giving money. Money is not enough. Money can be God, but they need your heart to love them. So spread your love everywhere you go. I have served on some great ministry teams over the years. When Christmas rolled around, we would like to take them out for a good bash to say thanks for all their service and sacrifice. Some years were different. However, once we scrapped our plans and did a service project together as our Christmas party instead. 74 of us descended on a local middle school and scattered out to help wherever we could. Two of us went to the librarian and said, "We are available for 2.5 hours. Put us to work. What do you want us to do?" Her little librarian's eyes got big. "Would you please just go through the whole fiction section and put the books back where they belong?" 5 man-hours later, we got to the ZS. She looked at our work and said, "Oh, you have no idea what a blessing this is. Honestly, I didn't have an idea, but for her, it was a blessing that made her day and saved her a lot of work." I walked into that school thinking I had nothing to give. I was wrong, not because I had something, but because she had a need and Christ had something to deliver to her through me. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. What do you give when you feel like you have nothing left? Listen, it's not that hard. It's not rocket science. You don't have to sacrifice your credit score to give physically. If you are in Christ, you are holy and pleasing to God, and Christ is in you. Think about that. Christ is in you. He is your life. Your body is a living sacrifice that manifests Jesus to the world today, just as Mary did 2,000 years ago. Holy Spirit, open my eyes to the needs around me. Keep me looking for people in our dark, dying, and desperate world who have nothing left to give. Open my eyes to the needs of those are closest to me. I offer myself as a sacrifice to be used by you. Use me to love them and help them in the name of Jesus. Help me to see that you loving them through me and an infinitely more valuable gift than anything money could buy. Hallelujah. Amen. We talk a lot about our rights in these days. God's gift, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right of the right to become children of God. You have heard it said that we are all God's children. It sounds wonderful, but it is not exactly true. We are God's offspring by birth, but becoming a child of God requires us to make a choice to accept his gift of salvation. John 13, part 16 reminds you of God's perfect gift to you, Jesus, and how you have free will to accept Jesus and become a child of God. Bible teaching will help you live well in a divided culture, fight spiritual battles, experience the power of faith, claim your identity in Christ, and grasp God's promise of rest. May it be as you say. I once bought my kids a set of batteries for Christmas with a note on it saying, toys not included. The Bible doesn't tell us much about Mary, but what I do know impresses me greatly. She has so little to give in the moment, but in the moment she gave all she had. As a Jew in a devout community, it's safe to assume that the great prophecies and theologies were read to her by candlelight before she went to bed year after year after year. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. When the prophecies began to unfold around her, she must have begun to see it for what it was. Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. Being a virgin, she knew this was a biological impossibility. But after some sincere questioning, she learned into the truth, choosing biblical truth over biological fact. I believe the Holy Spirit greatly encouraged her in this moment, reminding her of another truth that would have been part of her heritage. Nothing is impossible for God. All God asked of Mary was what she had to give. What did she had to give? Nothing. No, wait. She had two things, her body and her faith. She gave those to him. In obedience, she laid both before her Lord. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word to me be fulfilled. May Mary's faith and obedience be an encouragement to others like you and me, who find ourselves in places where we think we simply have nothing to give. Lord, by the power of your Spirit, give me the faith and obedience of Mary. I truly have nothing to give this world other than what you are already planning to give through me. I am your servant. May it be so. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.